Good evening. Today we are going to discuss about the contemporary development of world stock markets. So end of this particular session, you will be able to understand or list down all the recent developments in the world stock markets. Particularly, all right, welcome back. And in particular, we are discussing all these six recent developments in the world stock market, namely demutualization of stock exchanges and use of public float adjusted market cap in terms of the measuring the size of the equity market, and sustainability concerns, ESG concerns or thematic indices. And then we discuss something called high frequency trading, HFT in short, and standard industry classifications, and finally the market classifications. And first we will take the demutualization of stock exchanges. Before that, let me begin with setting the context for this discussion. Traditionally, stock exchanges or share markets are mutually owned by its members. Let me explain the structure. We have stock exchange, and this is a company limited by guarantee. As you know, there are so many different types of companies: company limited by guarantee, company limited by all the other different sets, types of companies. And here, this particular type is company limited by guarantee. Company limited by guarantees will have only members, not shareholders, but members. Usually in the stock exchanges, the members are the brokerage firms, because they mutually own the stock exchange in order to facilitate, in order to do the share trading business. Share trading business, they own the stock exchanges. Particularly, it is important to understand that these stock exchanges will have a regulatory role as well. When it comes to regulatory role, it is supposed to regulate investors, broker firms, and all the other stakeholders. When it comes to regulation, I know what comes to your mind is the capital market regulator. In Sri Lanka, it is Securities and Exchange Commission, and most of the countries, USA, it's SEC, and different countries have different capital market regulators. For example, if you take Singapore, it's Monetary Authority of Singapore, we call it MAS. And in Sri Lanka, in India, it is SEBI, SCBI, Capital Securities Exchange Board of India, and most of countries is SEC. They have the full regulatory authority of the capital market. However, stock exchanges also will have some regulatory role to be played by them. But when it comes to the regulatory role, they are supposed to regulate brokers, but brokers own the stock exchanges. Therefore, this has imposed some impediments for the capital market developments. But the recent trend is, the solution that's given to that issue is demutualization, because this is mutually owned by members, and the reverse of that is demutualized. Demutualized means they give up the ownership, and the stock exchanges will become yet another listed company. We call this process demutualization of stock exchanges. Having demutualized, it will be yet another listed company of the same exchange. For example, if the Colombo stock exchange is it is currently mutually owned, it is demutualized, then it will be a listed company, or it can be a listed company of the same exchange. And so in this context, let me take the advantage. There are several advantages of demutualized exchanges for the capital market in general and economy as a whole. And broadly, some of these are ability to tap foreign expertise to enhance strategic interest of the exchange, and opportunity for greater inflow of foreign direct investment from the potential alliances. Currently, in the mutualized environment, stock market is, or the stock exchange is, owned by its members. in that scenario, with the outside investors will not be able to invest or acquire or own that stock exchange. However, if that will become yet another listed company, then the foreign parties can invest in that particular company, so that they will come with their own expertise. Their own expertise, for example, now if we take Colombo example, Colombo Stock Exchange, for example, if we demutualize that one, and there will be different foreign parties, of course, stock exchanges will become interested in investing, and these investments will not be only monetary, but maybe with intellectual properties. So we will be able to, or the mutualized exchanges would be able to tap foreign expertise. And a more flexible governance structure, the fostering decisive action in response to changes in the business environment. Now, what really simply means is the governance structure would be fairly flexible, because there won't be any impediments for their regulatory role or the decision making process, because they would be playing in a competitive environment, because they would be competing with other stock exchanges, and flexible governance structure. And the wider shareholder participation in the ownership and governance of the exchange. Now, the decision will be made by the board of directors, and they will not have a trading interest in the stock exchange like broker firms, and access to wider sources of finance and more efficient allocation of financial resources, so that they can raise capital, because it's yet another listed company, so that they can use those finances more efficiently to compete with other stock exchanges and other market, wider range of investment products and sources of revenue for the exchange. Now that they're competing with other stock exchanges, inevitably they will be getting into different investment products and different diversifying their revenue sources, because it is very, very important. Currently, the most mutualized stock exchanges, they are fairly depending on the trading income. They don't depend on other investment income sources like trade of secondary data and providing other value-added services. And the more efficient, competitive business environment encouraging innovation. Of course, they are supposed to, now that they're supposed to compete with other stock exchanges, and there is no choice but to innovate new things, otherwise they will not be able to remain competitive among the others. Financial benefits for the initial shareholders of the new exchange to realize the value of IPO for the contribution to develop exchange. Of course, the initial shareholders or probably the members, so they will have an opportunity for them to exit and realize their value at the IPO level, because there would be an IPO, initial public offering, when the stock exchanges is initially listed. Publicly owned stock exchanges can be more professional in their business dealings in comparison to member-owned organizations. Of course, member-owned organizations, they will have a different, the company has to represent the members' interest, but in the widely on public stock exchange will be run by professional team of management who will not be answerable or responsible for its members, and but to shareholders. With the role played by stock shareholders will strengthen the management, and the organization would result in greater transparency in dealings, accountability and market disciplines, which is fairly obvious. And so this new trend, demutualization of stock exchanges, and the development tool that we are discussing today is the use of float adjusted market cap. When it comes to market capitalization, you may remember this is something that you have learned in your equity classes. Equity or the valuation classes, market capitalization is nothing but the size of the market, determined size of the company. As you know, that is calculated fairly by using fairly simple equation, issued quantity into market price. However, so this will help you understand the market determined size. Issued quantity, this is fairly stable over a period of time. However, if you take market price, that will keep on changing every moment by moment in a trading day. Therefore, as a result of this one, market capitalization would be a variable which would be going up and down. However, so this product of this one is the market capitalization. However, the publicly traded company, what is important more than the total size, what is important is the size available for general public or any average shareholder to trade. As you know, this out of this issued quantity, this will be held by so many different types of investors. Mainly there are two categories. One is institutional investors, other one is individual institutional investors is, I mean, that's nothing but the companies. Those who have excess money, they tend to invest those in publicly traded stocks. So those are called institutional investors, and other parties are the basic category is the individual investor. However, out of these holdings, some of these either institutional or individual, they may not trade that in the public market in general. For example, the company chairman owns some amount of shares, say 5%. We cannot expect him to trade that in the market in general, right? Of course, we call it strategic holding because he is keeping that for strategic purpose. As a result of that only, he may become the chairman of that company. Of course, chairman and chief executive officer and other high profile senior executives may hold such holdings. And likewise, there could be some other institutional investors or strategic investors may be holding a large quantity of that fund. All in all, we cannot expect them to trade that in the open market in general. Therefore, the issued quantity or the total issued quantity will not be available for trade, for trading purpose. Therefore, this total market capitalization will mislead in terms of the tradability of the particular company. Let's take a very large company, it says the market capitalization is this many billions. Yes, size is large. However, it is very important to understand, okay, out of that large size, how much is available for in general or for public trading. That's what this new development, instead of using the total market cap, now there is a measurement called float adjusted market capitalization. Before coming into that terms, now this is about the total market capitalization. Now we have different version of that one, and that version is the float adjusted market cap. And it's in terms of the calculation is fairly simple, right? Now this, if this total quantity is 100%, we calculate, if it is 100%, how much is available for public trading, we call it free float. That is something that is expected to float freely among public investors at any given day. Obviously, that should be something less than 100%. If it is 95%, that means only 5% is held by the strategic investors who don't generally trade every day or the regular basis. This is called public float. Or simply the float, and there are so many different terminologies used on this one. Simply, sometimes call it simply float, public float, and sometimes we call it investable weighting factor, IWF, we are referring the same percentage, right? And that particular name has come from because that is the amount that can be invested by any general investor, IWF, investable weight factor. But in Sri Lankan context, we use public float, free float, or simply the float. Simply float. And if you can calculate this percentage, for example, if it is 30%, it means nothing but 70% itself is held by strategic investors. Strategic investors and float adjusted market cap is nothing but this percentage into the total market cap. Total market cap. And all right, let's look at the definition. Public float or the free float represent the portion of shares of a corporation that are in the hands of public investors as opposed to locked in stock held by promoters, the founders of the company, company officers like chairman and CEO, and controlling interest investors or government. Sometimes government also may hold a particular percentage. For example, if we simply take Sri Lanka Telecom, 51% is held by the government. We cannot expect the government to trade that in the market on regular basis. Or in other words, that 51% is not available for regular trading. That's why it is strategic holding, right? And this is used to calculate the float adjusted market capitalization, as I alluded to earlier, and float adjusted indices, right? And before coming to that, the total market capitalization is say, total market capitalization is say 150 billion, and public float is say 15%. That means it should be then the float adjusted would be this into this. It would be some 22.25 billion. This is what is available for public trading. This is therefore it is known as float adjusted market capitalization. All right, so this is a measurement, better measurement to understand how much shares are or the how much the issues are, I mean the shares are available in terms of value for the public trading. This is particularly important when it comes to the calculation of market indices. And the float, we call them float adjusted indices, a better measurement of price movements or the in the publicly traded stocks. And as you know, this for the index calculation purpose, earlier we used to, before 2000, early 2000, we used to use total market capitalization, because when it comes to the calculation of daily price movements, we consider all the stocks irrespective of whether that is held by the public shareholders or the strategic shareholders. We consider everything. However, the purpose of the creation of index is to gauge the daily price movements, daily price, or the to determine the price direction of the daily price movements. Therefore, it is more appropriate to use only the publicly available trades, only the publicly available trades. Therefore, the public float adjusted market capitalization was used to calculate a different set of indices called float adjusted market cap. Nowadays, almost all the, there are still, there are very few number of indices calculated based on total market capitalization. However, most of the stock exchanges have moved to this regime where they use float adjusted market cap to calculate their indices. Or in other words, most equity market indices are now float calculated based on float adjusted market capitalization basis. For example, if we come back to Sri Lankan context, we have a index family of Sri Lankan stock market. We have all share price index, as well as we have a blue chip index called S&P Sri Lanka 20. Of course, S&P Sri Lanka 20, it derives is methodology from the globally accepted S&P methodology, and it uses float adjusted market cap to measure the size of the company. However, the local index is all share price index still uses total market capitalization, the basis to calculate the indices. And the third development that we are discussing today is the sustainability concerns shown by the stock exchanges. Now, long ago, we were talking about the profit. The purpose of doing business is the profit. Then after some time, then this 1P became 2P. Then the idea behind that was not only profit, we should be concerned about people as well. So right, the employee safety and the employee health and all the other concerns, 2P. And after some time again, we realized it's still not enough. We should be concerned, or we should be mindful about the planet also when we are doing businesses. Profit, people, the planet. So we should be concerned about all these three pillars when we are doing the business. It is very important. Now, in this context, what is the role that the stock exchanges can play in this regard? As I alluded earlier, the stock exchange will have the important regulatory role. So that through the stock exchanges, we can implement or we can encourage for companies or listed companies to adhere certain principles than other companies. So this is the idea behind this sustainability stock exchanges initiative. In 2009, so that's the context for this one, and so we are going to further discuss about this one particular sustainability initiative, SSE, Sustainability Stock Exchange Initiative. Remember, this is not generic term, I mean the generic thing. Sustainability Stock Exchange is a particular exercise by UN, United Nations organizations, right? And there are some other sustainability the programs as well. And so in particular, we are digging deeper here about SSE, and we are discussing its main objectives, background and history, and its partner exchanges, and benefits of joining sustainability stock exchange. Benefits in terms of the stock exchange's point of view, because in this particular apex body, the members would be the stock exchanges. And as I mentioned, there are some other initiatives as well. If some other initiative would be World Federation of Stock Exchanges, and Sustainability Stock Exchange Initiative is a different initiative. Right, what is SSE, Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative? The SSE initiative is a UN initiative that was inaugurated by the United Nations organization, working as a partnership among the UN, UN-supported organization, and stock exchanges, investors, companies, regulators, and governments. And that is how this has been formed. SSE initiative is convened by four organizations. This one is United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. That's a business arm of those who are looking into the business aspect of and the other one is Principles of Responsibility Investments, called PRI, and the other one is UN Global Compact, and finally the UNEP, United Nations Environmental Program Finance Initiative. So these are the four organizations that have co-convened this SSE initiative. The main objective of SSE, Sustainability Stock Exchange Initiative, to facilitate peer-to-peer learning platform. In one particular country, they are doing something to encourage the sustainability of the business, sustainability of the planet, sustainability of the people, and all these things. So that there has to be some common platform for the exchanges, stock exchanges, to come and sit and discuss and share their experiences. So this is the primary, one of the main objectives, to facilitate peer-to-peer learning platform for global exchanges to explore how stock exchanges can work together with investors, regulators, and companies to encourage sustainable investments. Sustainable investment. Sustainable investment is nothing but the investment that is concerned about environmental, social, and governance concerns. And the other major objective is to enhance the corporate transparency and performance in respect to environmental, social, and corporate governance issues. In short, we call it ESG, environmental, social, and governance. And the background, or rather the history of this initiative, as I mentioned, this was an initiative of UN, UNGC meeting in 2004 at UN headquarters in New York with a number of global stock exchanges. And so that was the start of this one. In 2008, UNCTAD and PRI collaborated at the UN headquarters in Geneva with investors, financial information providers, stock exchanges, and public policy officials to promote responsible investment in emerging markets. And I will explain in a later slide what emerging market is. There are different types of market classification. That's also a new development in this particular arena. And in 2009, UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon opened the first SSE Global Dialogue in New York. So that was the real start of this SSE, so Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative. And you can see a picture of that one. And these are the historical events. First SSE Global Dialogue in New York, 2009. And again, that was held in 2015 as well. And then second one in 2010 in Geneva, China. And third one in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil in 2012. And fourth one was held in Geneva in 2014. So in this global dialogues, all the members of stock exchanges who are concerned about promoting environmental, social, and governance principles, and they get together and share their experience and in order to do this, in order to help the UN to meet these objectives better. And the partner exchanges, there are 47 partner exchanges of SSE, and the benefits of joining SSE from the stock exchange point of view, what would be the benefits of joining an organization like this SSE, Sustainable Stock Exchange? A global platform for exchanges to demonstrate leadership and understanding the sustainability related opportunities and challenges facing the capital market, so that there's a place for them to come and share their experience and learn from others and teach to others and so on. And so this is a fantastic opportunity for the members who have joined this organization, sharing the best practices among professionals from all the segments of investment, maybe regulators, market operators, fund managers, investors, investment and investment value chain, and offers unique stand for multi-stakeholder learning. And an exchange can differentiate itself from competitors. Remember, I talked about the competition among the stock exchange when they are demutualized and when they become listed companies, and they are competing with other stock exchanges. So this should be a fantastic opportunity for them to differentiate themselves from the other competitive stock exchanges, because if they are a member of the Sustainability Stock Exchange Initiative, that means so they are concerned about the sustainability issues, so they can differentiate themselves from the competitive exchanges. And an array of resources for support and implementation of sustainability initiatives. So there are so many events hosted by the SEC, so that it can be part of these the members can be part of these organize these events. An opportunity to join SSC consultative group where stock exchange will play a crucial role in setting the strategic direction of the SSC initiative. Right, so this will give you a comparison of sustainability, because Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative, and they are completely dedicated for the sustainability concern. But there is some other, there is yet another world apex body of stock exchanges called the World Federation of Exchanges, where they do so many things, and at the same time they have a sustainability arm as well, sustainability arm as well. And so they're working together, they're not competing each other. Hey, you also work on this area, we also work on this area. They're not competing, but they're complementing each other. So this table will give you some sort of comparison between these two in terms of their theme, objective, and number of members, and the financial commitments from the members' point of view, and the mutual promotion. They mutually promote each other. Mutually promote in the sense they are in SSC is promoting WFE and vice versa. Right. Before coming into this topic, let me ask you a question. How do we make money in the stock market? Stock market is where there are buyers and sellers trading or buying and selling in the market. As a result of that, the prices will go up and down. How do we make money? If the price, when the we should buy at when the price is low, and we should sell and exit from your investment when the prices are higher. That's the fundamental logic. We sometimes call it or refer it as the golden rule in finance: buy low, sell high. Buy low, sell high. And at the same time, as I mentioned, keep that in mind. That's very important for you to understand what this high frequency trading is. Particularly, we are discussing about this, what high frequency trading is and why HFT is perceived to be a big problem. Sometimes it is considered as big problem, HFT. And what HFT firms are saying about the allegations against them. And the prevalence, how prevalent it is, and the prerequisites for HFT. What are the things that should be fulfilled for this to happen? High frequency trading. Right. And I would like to recommend you this book if you are very interested about this high frequency trading. Michael Lewis, Flash Boys. And so this is a very good book on this area. So this would be, this can be your reading material if you are really interested on what. So what is HFT? As I mentioned, the prices will go up and down. And for example, can we use it according to this graph? Can you make money? Of course, if you can buy somewhere here, if you can sell somewhere here, of course you can make money. Buy, sell. If you can buy somewhere here, sell somewhere here, of course we can do that. However, look at the x-axis. According to this one, we should buy at 9.45. We should sell at 11.15. Of course, we can do that. However, can we make money somewhere here? If the time period is shorter, it is very impossible, for a human to act. Monitor this one, take the decision, and take the buy decision and fill the buy order and so on, and put the sell order. Therefore, if the time period is very short, it is very difficult to do this manually. Therefore, we can ask a computer to do this one. So that is high frequency trading, because computer will monitor the price movements. If it is going up, of course, it will make the buy automatic buy orders or sell orders. Buy orders and sell orders. So this will happen constantly, constantly in very high speed, very high speed. So that it's an algorithmic trading. The computer, we tell the computer, computer will do the trading. It sends the order and everything will be done by the computer. We don't want to make any intervention, right? And this is what I was explaining earlier, buy low, sell high. And this is how we can make money. And just an example, buy here, sell here, buy here, sell here, so that we can instruct the computer. We can instruct the computer, and so then the programmers will do that programming part. So then, and this would be the high frequency trading room would be something like this. While these are the computer servers are doing the business. They are looking at, they are scanning the stock exchanges. They are scanning the trading, the trading systems to find out where to buy and where to sell. Buy low signals. They will constantly scan the market. If the criteria is fulfilled, of course, then automatically they will issue the buy and sell order, and the computer will do the trading automatically. And so that is what the high frequency trading is, and the prevalence of high frequency trading and US in the United States is common from that started in 2099, and that was the start. And then Europe, then the Tokyo Stock Exchanges, and Singapore is 2011, that's the most recent one. And in Bombay, India, and NSE is 2009. And one question, is it available in Sri Lanka? No, it is not available in Sri Lanka, high frequency trading. And you will understand why it is not prevalent in Sri Lanka when we discuss the prerequisites for high frequency trading. And you'll be surprised if you see these percentages. Market share 48% means, as of 2014 statistics, 48% of the value of the transaction has come from the high frequency trading or machine trading or the algorithmic trading. Algorithmic is the program trading. The computer has been instructed to do the trading on behalf of you. And it is fairly high, and in certain markets is moderately high, 30% in India and so on. And a 50 percentage of US equity shares traded in 2006 to 2014. And as you can see earlier, this going down, and sometimes it was as high as to 61% of the equity shares. This is the number of shares traded in the market. And allegations of against the high frequency trading, there are two. One is front running, and the other one is exchange market arbitrage. And you should be aware about this. Front running. Front running is in this HFT environment. The computers are powerful. Computers are constantly scanning the trading system of stock trading system of stock exchanges. These are high frequency HFT firms. We call this is a firm wide business, and we call them high frequency HFT firms. And they frequently scan the system. They say that, and as a result of their scanning, and they found out that someone is making a large trade by order. By order, and before that comes to the market, before that comes to market, so that now that they are super fast, they can go and meet this order. They can go and meet this order, and so that they can be the counterpart of that the buy order, and that's how that's one of the allegations leveled against this high frequency trading. And prerequisites: the fragmented markets, the market should have so many different fragments. That is, like, for example, even in one country, there should be so many different markets, so that there will be some the mispricings, so that they can easily scan this. If we take India, then NSE, we have Bombay Stock Exchange, BSE, and the Tata is listed on both of stock exchanges. Theoretically, Tata should be traded at, irrespective of the place where that is traded, it should be traded at the same price because of the law of one price. However, there is no reason always that's to be there, because the within NSE, the price is determined based on demand and supply of that one within that exchange, and BSE, price of Tata is determined based on demand and supply there. You have the two prices individually determined, and it may be different. So this is a fantastic opportunity for high frequency traders, and there, because the trading is done by the computers, they can scan these markets and find out the mispriced assets, so that they can quickly place relevant order, either buy or sell, and make money. If the fragmented markets are there, it's a good opportunity, and there would be arbitrage opportunity and downward pressure on exchange trading fees, and the low latency trading systems, and latency about 10 milliseconds preferred, and low explicit trading fees. Because they are doing so many trades, therefore they need the trading commission, or the fee should be very low. HFT strategies generate low margins, and therefore it is important to have low trading fee. The other prerequisite is high liquidity. It is very important to have high level of liquidity, because otherwise what will happen is there would be an opportunity for them to do a trade, but the liquidity is not there, they will not be able to realize that one. Therefore, it is very important to have high liquidity in the market. And due to low margins, high turnover required, because they need to do, you know, even within one trade, they will realize a very small margin. So what do? They do so many trades, and that's why it is very important to have higher liquidity. Small tick sizes, more price steps to find arbitrage, and this is not applicable. And is some sort of evaluation of prerequisites based on three different markets, as you can see. Right, regulatory concern stands on HFT high frequency trading, and this is, I'm quoting here, the statement made by the chairman of USSEC with regard to the high frequency trading. The SEC should not roll back the technology clock or prohibit algorithmic trading. Algorithmic trading is nothing but the trading done by the computer based on certain algorithm, computer programming. But we are assessing the extent to which specific elements of computer-driven trading environment may be working against the investors rather than for them. Whether they are now, what they are mentioning, they are in alert. They are concerned about this one. And standard industry classification, right? The next development that we are discussing today, standard industry classification, right? You may have heard the term, the popular historical the proverb, don't put your all eggs in one basket. That is exactly true when it comes to the investments in stock markets. It doesn't mean, what it means is you should not invest in only in one stock. You should put that in different stocks. Are you all right now? Not really. If you put all your stocks in, all your money in one company, of course, you are exposed to that company, right? But if you put in three telecommunication companies, three telcos, of course, you have mitigated, you have diversified your risk to a certain level, but still you are exposed to the sector risk because you have put all your money in the telecommunication sector. What really needs to happen is you should put your money, or the investors should put, or investors should invest their money across different sectors, maybe leisure industry, retail industry, FMCG, manufacturing, telcos, and so on. Therefore, the industry, there has to be a mechanism for investors to understand the different common links on different industries, However, what was the earlier practice was the different stock exchanges use their own classifications. India has one, their own classification, and Sri Lanka had one, their own classification, and other markets had their own classification. So that is all right for local investors. That's all right when we have one common Sri Lankan classification within our market. Local investors are all right. However, if you look at from the point of view of the individual foreign investors whose investment radar is more than one country, now they are in not in good shape. Why? Because if they are investing in Sri Lanka and some other country, Sri Lanka uses a different sector classification and some other country uses a different sector classification, sometimes they are not able to compare like to like. Therefore, it's somewhat difficult to compare these two companies. Because of the increased global focus of equity investments, what is important is not the geographical demarcations, but the industries. Therefore, there has to be one common classification for all markets so that local investors, as well as especially institutional, especially the international investors, foreign investors, they are very comfortable, because then they are able to do their comparisons very well. They are very confident because they are able to identify similar companies, because everyone follows the common classification, industry classification system. There's a question. Let me attend that. So what are such classification systems? There are a couple of classification systems. We are digging deep here. Global Industry Classification, Global Industry Classification Standard, GICS, because that is widely used. It covers 95% of the global equity market capitalization. And other one is ICB, Industry Classification Benchmark. These are the two widely used common industry classification standards. Now, there's a tendency of more and more stock exchanges adopting these common classification or standard classification systems to classify their companies. And as I mentioned, we are digging deeper on GICS. What is GICS? Stand for Global Industry Classification Standard. As you can see, it's a global standard. It's common if stock market follows that one, so that those companies can be compared, because everyone has followed the same classification system. Stand for Global Industry Classification Standard, and developed in 1999 by Morgan Stanley Capital International, MSCI, and famous index provider, Standard and Poor's. So they jointly developed in 1999 this classification system. And it's nothing but a set of rules how to calculate, how to classify companies into different industry sectors. Aims to enhance the investment research and asset management process globally when that is present, so that investors, fund managers, and other capital market participants are very comfortable in doing comparing their work. And this is particularly important because it is hierarchical. It is hierarchical because of this hierarchical structure, so that it will have different levels, so that you can do your classification at different levels. In the next slide, I believe I would explain what this hierarchical structure is. It has sectors, industry groups, industries, and sub-industries. And in the next slide, you will better understand what it is. We have sectors at the top of this one. This is a more general category. Industry group is would be the second one. Then industry, we have industry, and there we have sub-industry. Then only we have companies. We are assigning the company to sub-industry, and it will have its own industry and its own industry group. And finally, it has its own sector. So in other words, any given company will have four different levels of classifications. The importance of that one is, if a particular person is interested about very general, very, very general analysis, so that he can do that at the sector level, but he needs some, more detailed level analysis, he can do that at the industry group level. If he needs very granular level analysis, of course, he can come to this fourth level, sub-industry level, and do the analysis. So this is very flexible. This is very flexible. And although we don't discuss ICB, industry classification benchmark, that also has a hierarchical structure of four layers. And so this is a different representation of the same structure. We have GICS. Within that, we have sectors. It has 10 sectors. And any given sector will have some number of industry groups. And then any industry group will have some number of industries. And within given industry, it will have sub-industry. And finally, sub-industries will have companies. Sub-industries will have companies. And when you take numbers, in the JIC structure, it has 10 different sectors, 24 different industry groups, 67 industries, and finally 156 sub-industries. You can visualize this as a tree, and finally at the fourth level we assign companies to each sub-industry, so that the rest of the classification will be automatically defined. If we assign a particular company into, say, the industry 2, that means it will belong to the industry one, and industry group 1, and finally sector 1. And that's how the assigning companies will happen. And there are four very important characteristics that you should be aware about this classification. The JIC structure is universal. Why it is universal? Because that applies to all the 95% of the global market capitalization. Or in other words, it has covered 43,000 listed companies in 127,000 markets. So this classification is available. So that makes investors' life easier, so that they can compare and they can understand the industry better, rather than looking at their own individual classification systems for each market. And it is universal and it's accurate. Why it is accurate? Because that is able to accurately reflect the state of industries in the equity investment universe, because it is hierarchical. So that the company can be assigned to the most appropriate place, and it is flexible. Of course, as I alluded earlier, it is very flexible. The structure offers four levels of analysis, ranging from most general sector to the more specialized sub-industry. So that those who are interested can do the analysis at any of those four levels. If it is very general, of course, analysis would be sector level. If it is very granular level, very specified, very specialized, of course, analysis can be done at the fourth level, or in other words, sub-industry level. And it is evolving. As I explained earlier, this structure currently has 10 sectors and 24 industry groups, 67 industries, and finally 156 sub-industries. But this is evolving based on the changes on the business dynamic, business environment, and this is annually reviewed, the structure, and as a result of that one, there will be certain additions to this tree, or sometimes certain the amalgamation of certain elements, and likewise, this structure is evolving. As I explained, this was invented, this was developed in 1999, and the structure is amended 7 times so far. And you're good to understand. You're good to understand about this the methodology. Methodologies will help us understand how we assign a particular company to particular sub industry. And we will simply, quickly go through this one. A company is assigned to the lowest end of the hierarchy, to the sub industry. I explained this one earlier. We have sector. Then we have industry group, and we have industry, then we have sub-industry, and it is to this sub-industry that we assign the company, right? Sub-industry. So we use the methodology for this part, how to add a particular company to a particular sub-industry. The rest of the classification is already determined by the existing classification tree, and primarily based on revenue and earnings and market perception are also considered. And this classification is based on revenue, and in very simple terms, what it will do is it will look at, okay, what is the company's revenue source, and so it will be assigned to the sub industry where the most appropriate sub-industry. Right? A primary source for information used are the annual reports and financial statements. Other sources include investment research reports and other industry information. For a new company, it would be the prospectus. And this is based on publicly available information from annual reports and other financial statements. If it is a newly listed company, of course, there won't be annual reports. But in that scenario, the information contained in the prospectus will be used. And still we are continuing with the methodology. As a general rule, the company, now this is interesting. Now this is the most important part. As a general rule, the company is assigned, the company is classified into sub-industry whose definition most closely describes the business activities that generate the majority of the company's revenue. That's the fundamental rule for this one. And however, a company engaging two or more substantially different business activities, none of which contributes 60% or more revenues, is classified in the sub-industry that provides a majority of the both the company's revenue and earnings. So when we have more than two revenue sources, they will simply consider both, and they will look at the majority, the sector, the business activity that provides the majority of the revenue, so that will be assigned to that particular sub-industry. And when no sub-industry provides the majority, if we are not able to identify a clear majority, like 52% versus 48%, there is no clear majority. So that they will do some extensive analysis to find out what the most appropriate sub-industry is. Sub-industries. And a company significantly diversified across three or more sectors are, and none of which contributes the majority of revenue. Of course, if the majority is there, then we will go with the majority. But if it is diversified, it has so many different revenue sources, and at the same time, there is no clear majority, so that will be classified as the conglomerate sub-industry. Conglomerates or multi-sector. There are two versions of diversified sector, multi-sector holding or the industry conglomerates. And in case of a new company issue, the classification will be determined based on primarily on the description of company activities and the performer result given in the prospectus. We mentioned this earlier. The company's industry classification will be reviewed either when a significant corporate restructuring occurs or when new financial report is available. When that is made available, okay, this will be reviewed. And still we are in the methodology. In the event of above, guidelines should not appropriately capture. Sometimes these guidelines may not be able to capture the real scenario with a particular company. Business activities classification will be determined based on extensive analysis. These are exceptional cases. And if you are interested about learning about this further, you can find out the methodology or the methodology simple by using simple Google search. If you look at the GICS, Global Industry Classification Standard, and so it will provide you all the details, especially the classification tree, the labels and so on. And we take a small break before continuing. Welcome back after the break. The last development that we are discussing is market classifications, stock exchange, stock markets, or there are sometimes this is referred as country classification or market classification. The country and the market, those two terms are used interchangeably, country classification or market classification. Each country is classified into a different sector or different league, I would say, right? And let's look at what we are planning to discuss. The classification, the brief history of terminology, and the purpose of classification is very important. And the classification overview by two different companies, MSCI and Financial Times Stock Exchange FTSE. And the classification analysis of these two, Morgan Stanley classification, MSCI classification, and FTSE classification and comparative analysis. We are mainly focused on the MSCI classification, which is widely used. And the classification basis, classify to arrange in classes or categories according to shared qualities or characteristics. The market classification could be conducted on any of the following characteristics, to name a few, based on area of coverage, time, degree of competition, or developments. And here we focus on financial markets in a nation's economy and utilizes predetermined criteria to determine the level of development. So this classification will be based on the level of development, and under this method, nation's financial market would be categorized under one of the three categories. Now that's based on the level of development of the capital market. Of course, the one end would be developed markets, the other end would be frontier market, or in other words, less developed, and other is developed markets. The category in between is the emerging. They have emerged from frontier markets towards the developed market, but still they are not at the developed market level, and so they are known as the emerging markets. So all in all, what really happens here is the countries or markets are classified into one of these three categories. It could be either developed market, frontier market, or an emerging market. Who does this classification? Countries are classified under the method primarily by world's index providers such as MSCI, Morgan Stanley Capital International, FTSE, or S&P Dow Jones indices. These classification methods are brought by the index companies, and this classification method is hence geared towards the global investor and international investment community as a whole. And so these classification methods, they consider the perception of the general wider belief or acceptance of the investment community around the globe. And sophisticated investors, or the usually large institutional investors, can utilize these classifications to develop funds or trading strategies which are targeted towards specific classifications and hence with distinctive identifiable investment purposes. I will explain this in detail later. And the availability of the classification would aid global investors to achieve desired degree of diversification. So that the global investors or international investors, foreign investors, can, whose investment radar is the entire globe, can put their money not only in developed markets but in frontier markets as well as emerging markets. So because of this classification, this is a different type of the market sector classification or industry classification. This is from the global level. We are classifying these into three different baskets: developed, emerging, and frontier, so that the investment managers can diversify their investment across these three sectors. And so they can allocate certain amount of funds to be invested completely on a particular sector. For example, now HSBC, one example is HSBC Frontier Markets Fund. Frontier market funds that is predominantly invested in frontier markets. Frontier markets, we are yet to discuss what those markets are, right? So that is dedicated for to be invested in frontier markets. Likewise, there would be HSBC emerging market fund, developed market funds, and likewise there would be different types of investment funds. And again, Templeton Frontier Market Fund, Templeton Private Frontier Market Fund, and these are meant to be invested only in frontier markets. And and iShares MSCI Emerging Market ETF, don't worry about this. This ETF is a different investment tool, and MSCI Emerging Market Fund. So this particular fund is completely invested only in different emerging markets, so they can diversify their risk across different markets. Right, the particular question that we need to ask is, so why it is important? Why it is important to know this, classify these companies? So this, just pause the video and think a little bit the reason behind the importance of this classification. Why it is important to classify companies or countries or markets like this? Right, the importance, in order to answer that question, this equation will be helpful. If you take frontier, that means least developed, developed markets, right, and emerging, in between. So why it is important to classify the countries or markets like this? Now when you take the correlation between these two, any two markets, the correlations of returns are very low. Therefore, it is justified to put justified to diversify their investment across these sectors, because then the correlation of these two, correlation is very low. When that is very low, so that we can achieve very low level of portfolio risk. As you know, when this is square term, this is positive, this is positive, this is positive, and the weights, these are positive, and this positive, and this positive. Only thing that we can take a lesser value or a negative value is the correlation. When this is lower, we will end up achieving the lowest possible portfolio risk. That's why it is important to club or the classify these markets into the similar groups as frontier, emerging, and developed markets. And so we are digging deeper into, there are two main classification standards or overviews. One is classification by MSCI. We call it MSCI country classification or MSCI market classification. And so we are discussing that in detail. This is the classification. They have classified, MSCI classifies markets into developed markets, emerging markets, and frontier markets. As you can see, I believe you can read names. So these are arranged according to geographical spread. Asian, four Asian region, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka, and Vietnam. And if we take developed markets, and the American markets are Canada and US, and Europe and Middle East, you can see a whole list of markets. And emerging markets, Americans, Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Mexico, and Peru. And Asian developed markets, emerging markets are China, India, Indonesia, Korea, Malaysia, and so on. This is a simple, the overview of the classification done by MSCI. Now, for this purpose also, it has a methodology. MSCI regularly reviews the market classification of all countries. The markets are classified like this, doesn't mean that they will remain as it is forever. Right? For example, now, if you take Pakistan, Pakistan will move to emerging markets, Asian emerging markets, in May 2017. Likewise, based on their level of development, certain if the particular market is not meeting criteria, that will be downgraded back to the lower level. Or else, if the market is developed and is meeting more and more criteria, that will be upgraded to the next level. Likewise, this is an example. Pakistan will be upgraded to the emerging market level next year. Likewise, the particular agency who is doing this classification will regularly review the market classification of all countries included in MSCI indices to ensure that they remain reflective of the evolution of the different markets and continue to reflect the standards of the underlying market classification. And in particular, markets in the assessments under the classification framework serve as the basis for determining the market that will be reviewed for potential market reclassification as part of annual market classification review. What they do is they do conduct annual market classification review. They, one by one, they would review all the markets that are classified under classification, and to make sure whether that should remain in the same sector, or they should be downgraded, or they should be upgraded. And once MSCI determines, based on market classification framework, that a given market may qualify for potential reclassification, it will be added to the list of market under review, a watch list, right? And MSCI then may launch a public consultation on the proposed reclassification to gather views from the investment community. For example, technically, the MSCI, the classification provider, may decide, okay, this particular market should be upgraded. They won't do it arbitrarily simply because the particular market is meeting the criteria. And so they will be temporarily put under something called watch list, and they would ascertain the opinion from the global investment community. Because in addition to meeting the set criteria, the investment community should be ready to understand, ready to accept the particular market classification. market reclassification. Therefore, after the public consultation, only they would conclude the reclassification. And we are continuing with the MSCI classification methodology. MSCI may also remove market from, yes, that's about the downgrade, may remove from the review list of reclassification proposal has not been endorsed by investments for several consecutive years due to the inadequate progress of market accessibility levels. And every June, they would conduct the annual review, and while adhering to regular timeline with such communication helps provide greater predictability and is less disruptive market normal functioning. MSCI may also from time to time exercise the prudent discretion. Yes, usually they do some discretion when it comes to certain matters in the classification. Right. So I kept on using the classification criteria. Now we are getting into that one. Okay, what are the criteria that are to be met by the markets that are classified? The MSCI market classification framework consists of following three criteria. Now it gauges information about economic development and the size and the liquidity, size of the market and the liquidity of the market, and the market accessibility, how freely can the market be accessed by the investors, right? And these are the three main themes that they would consider for their criteria. In order to be classified in a given investment universe, the country must meet the requirements of all three criteria as described in the table below. Remember, there could be different set of criteria for the economic development, different criteria for the market liquidity, and different criteria for market accessibility. The next table in the next page will detail all these criteria. As you can see, economic development is measured under one item, sustainability of economic development. And for the size and the liquidity, second criteria will be measured under four different criteria. Now it talks about number of companies meeting these three requirements, and the market accessibility criteria, the third criteria, will be measured based on four different sub criteria. And as you can see, for numeric variables, you can see the threshold values, and if I explain for someone to be frontier market, to fall under frontier market, of course there is no requirement with regard to the economic development. It's irrelevant. It's not considered. And even for emerging markets, it's not a requirement. But for someone to be a developed market, there has to be a requirement. There has to be the value to be met. And the note one, the countries GNI per capita 25 above the World Bank high income threshold for last consecutive years, and that's what the requirement for this one is for a developed markets. But when it comes to the size and liquidity of the particular market, and this is what the requirement is, number of companies meeting the following standard index criteria. There has to be number of companies, for example two companies meeting these three criteria. That's for frontier market. For frontier market, there has to be two companies meeting full market cap. We know what the difference between the full market and the float adjusted market cap we developed at the beginning of this lecture. Float market cap should be $49 million, and full market cap should be at least $330 million, and the securities liquidity should be 2.5% of ATV. ATVR is the measurement of the liquidity. This is measured in terms of as a percentage, which is higher, the better the liquidity is. And likewise, you can see for emerging market, there has to be three companies at least three companies meeting these three criteria, and for someone to be for a particular market to be a developed market, there has to be at least five companies meeting these three criteria. And if they meet, so they have met the size and liquidity criteria. Size and liquidity criteria. And under that category, that criteria, market accessibility criteria, this will be measured based on these three sub criteria. Openness to foreign ownership. That means what's the level of ownership, openness of the particular market for foreign investors, foreign owners. Easy. Ease of capital inflow also, how easy that money can be taken in and out of the particular market. Efficiency of operational framework and stability of institutional framework. Those are somewhat vague, but you will soon see how they are measured. And of course, these are qualitative variables. For qualitative variables, these are the levels that it can have. It has something called at least some to be met, and it should be significant, or it should be very high, and so on. And as you can see, this qualitative variable, for example, openness to foreign ownership is measured through a couple of variables again. Ease of capital inflow outflow, that will be measured based on couple of variables again. And all this, all four qualitative variables will be measured by using further subcategories. You will see that in a while. And before going into that section, if a country or market does not fall in even under frontier, can that happen? Of course, that can happen. We call them, yes, they fall under standalone markets. That means they are not even be able to be classified as frontier markets. They are known as frontier standalone markets. And a couple of examples are in Americas, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, and Europe and Middle East and Africa. There are so many countries that are classified as standalone markets. That means they are even below the frontier markets, right? If you can recall, so this is the qualitative criteria. Remember the openness of the market, openness to foreign ownership. So that is measured based on four different subcategories. So they are ascertaining information about investor qualification requirement. What's the investor qualification requirements? That means there would be some qualification criteria for investors to come to the market. We call them qualified investors. If there is no qualified investors, no qualification for investors, that means anyone can come. For example, if there is a rule saying, okay, you should have a 500 million net worth for you to come to this market, that means that's a qualified investor, because any investor cannot come. Only those who are meeting that criteria only can come to the market. So investment qualification requirement, whether that is there or not, right? Usually the international standard is what is good is the absence of investor qualification requirement. And ownership limit, is there a limit for foreign ownership level? For example, in Sri Lanka, in the banking sector, foreigners cannot own more than 15%. There's a limit, foreign ownership limit. Likewise, is there a limit for foreign ownership, right? Foreign room level and equal right to foreign investors. So these are the other variables that they would ascertain to determine this particular qualitative variable. Of course, then the ease of capital inflow outflow, it is measured based on two different sub-criteria. Capital flow restriction level, whether there is a capital flow restriction level, and foreign exchange market liberalization level, and that's the other variable. And third one, the efficiency of operational framework is measured based on so many different sub criteria, and stability of institutional framework is not does not have any sub criteria that is directly measured. So that any of these sub criteria answers would be double plus. That means that's good, no issue, no problem. And the other end, yes, is problematic. Improvements needed. This one. And somewhere in between, no major issues, only one plus. So that this can be answers for these sub criteria can be either plus plus, one plus, or minus stroke question mark. Now this SL position means Sri Lanka's situation with regard to this one. SL means here I have indicated Sri Lankan position. For the first one, investor qualification requirement, one plus. We have got for Sri Lanka in the evaluation, we have got one plus. That means second category, I mean no major issues, not plus plus, that means not no issues. Right? So the issue here is there's a qualification requirement. Foreign institutional investors, they need to get the approval from the Securities and Exchange Commission before coming into the market. That's some sort of qualification. Without that, they cannot come. The qualification is there. And all the other areas, foreign ownership limit, no issues. Foreign, all the other areas, no problem. And capital flow restriction level, no problem. Here is a problematic. I have marked the problematic areas in yellow. When they don't give plus plus, that means no issues category, always they give reasons. They give reasons as a part of their assessment, so that the member countries or other classified countries or markets can go through them and they can be working on all these areas to improve their status. And in the next slide, you can see the foreign qualification requirement. Remember, we haven't got plus plus. We have got one plus. That means it's no major issues. And they are given the reason. International investor, right? Reasons for Sri Lanka's lower rating for 6 qualitative criteria. And first one is, we have got one plus. Remember, what's the best one? Plus plus. No major issues. Second level is plus, one plus, that means only no major issues, and the other is improvements needed, the worst category or the lowest category. And they have given the reason for us to get why we have got only one plus for three in investor qualification requirement. International investors, institutional investors are required to obtain an approval from the Sri Lankan Securities and Exchange Commission prior to entry into the market, as I alluded. So that's the reason for us to get somewhat lower rating for that one. And what does really this mean? It is given here in investor qualification requirement. Let's see what it says. The international standard for developed markets is the absence of any investor qualification. That's why the international standard is the absence. What is good is the absence of investor qualification requirements. There's a level playing field. Anyone can come to the market. Right? Near the other end of the spectrum, a qualified institutional investor license system is highly problematic, as it discriminates not only between domestic and foreign investors, but also among different institutional investors. The requirement of qualified institutional investor license would lead to a low assessment. Of course, the qualification is there, that will lead to a low level of assessment. And the second area that we have not got plus plus, that means the best category, foreign market liberalization level. There are constraints on the onshore currency market, and likewise, you can see how they have given the reasoning for the lower rating. Right? Investor registration and account setup, and the clearing and settlement, all and trading, and transferability and all the reasons they have given. And however, please be mindful that this is based on 2014 review. The latest review would have been 2016 June. So I encourage you to find the latest 2006 latest available report, the review report, 2016 June report, and study these areas. Right, having classified companies, so what is next? So they put all the markets into three different baskets: emerging, frontier, and the developed markets. Then thereafter, they need to provide some sort of indicator, common indicator, to gauge the price of these common baskets. For that purpose, they need to create different indices. Likewise, there are indices for frontier market, emerging market, and the developed markets. And say, for example, they take let me go back to this right. If a particular country is falling under frontier category, so these two companies will go to that index. If it is emerging market, of course these three companies will be qualified for that particular index. Likewise, this MSCI frontier market indices captures the large and mid-cap representation across 24 frontier market countries, and index includes 128 constituents, nothing but companies covering about 85% of the free float adjusted market capitalization in the country. Now you know what free float adjusted market capitalization. Until today, before this lecture, you were well aware about market capitalization. Now you are aware about the latest concept of market capitalization. Float adjusted market capitalization is nothing but the market capitalization into the publicly available percentage of holdings. And so this MSCI frontier market index, why it is MSCI? Because that's the company that is doing this classification. And the equally prominent other classification is classification done by FTSE, Financial Times Stock Exchange, FTSE classification. Then when they do that, so that is that will contain FTSE frontier market index and so on. And these are some historical numbers or the performances of these particular indices. Likewise, MSCI frontier market index, right? And these are some details. And frontier market 100, they have taken not all the frontier market but the largest 100, right? Let's see what the description is about. MSCI frontier markets 100 index is a representation and more easily replicable alternative to its broadest parent index, MSCI frontier market index. And the MSCI Frontier Markets 100 Index includes approximately 100 of largest, most liquid constituent of the parent index. Remember the previous index, Frontier Market Index? We take the largest 100 out of that one and we create a separate index, MSCI FM100, Frontier Market 100 Index. And so it is companies are, I mean, the stock markets are, the stock exchanges, stock markets, so the markets are trying to get into these classification. Why? Because then they will be under the radar of institutional foreign investors, and because of they are represented in that index. As I mentioned earlier, there are certain funds that are dedicated to be invested in these markets. Therefore, those funds will automatically come to these markets, and so we, this is yet another index. However, we did not discuss about the FTSE classification. There is a difference between these two. The major difference is it classifies into markets into four different sectors. Sorry, four different market types. And of course, one is developed, other one is frontier. And then what is then the other two? It has two versions of emerging markets. One is, secondary emerging. Other one is advanced emerging. This is FTSE classification, by the way. FTSE market classification. What we discuss in detail is MSCI classification. And just be aware about this difference between these two. It also will have its own set of criteria, not these criteria, but its own different set of criteria. If the particular market is meeting some of them, will fall under frontier. In addition to that, if it meets some other set of criteria, so that it will fall under the secondary emerging. It further reflects some more, to satisfy some more criteria, predetermined set of criteria, it will fall under advanced emerging category. And if it fulfills or satisfies almost all the required criteria, that will be falling under the developed market category. And any questions? So in this lecture we discuss about the contemporary development of world stock exchanges, and so we discuss particularly demutualization of stock exchanges. So as a result of that, the stock exchanges will be the listed company of the same stock exchanges, right? So that they would be competing, or they are profit oriented, and when the mutual stock exchanges, they are mutually owned by the brokers, and they are not profit oriented, they are not for profit organizations, therefore they are not focused on competing and doing the making profit, but they are simply maintaining the status quo. But when they become listed entities, or then they have shareholders in the mutually owned companies, mutually owned stock exchange, they have members. But when they become demutualized stock exchanges, then they will be companies with shareholders. Then there will be a pressure from shareholders for them to do better and make profit, so that they are striving at the end of the day, and that will end up with the developed market. So that's and the use of float adjusted market cap, and as against the total market cap. Total market cap is the total market size held by all the investors, but all the quantities are held by the investors are not available for the public trades in general. Therefore, what is the more relevant indicator is the float adjusted market cap. What we simply do is we take the total market cap and we multiply it by the public holding percentage. Public holding percentage is, for example, is 30%. It means 30% of the issued quantity of a particular stock is held by public, which will be available for publicly float, and it's 30%. 30% is usually is calculated based on the public holding definition. The definition would be different from market to market. In Sri Lanka, we have a different definition, and there are some globally accepted definitions as well. One such example is the public holding percentage definition by S&P, the famous index company. And the other development that we discuss is the sustainability stock exchanges initiative, ESG concerns. Now stock exchanges are more concerned. Now perhaps that would be one of the best ways to promote sustainability or environmental, social and governance concerns among companies, because the stock exchanges will have some regulatory role to be played. and we did not discuss thematic indices as such, and high frequency trading because of the development of the technology. The technology, the computers can be used to make the investment decision, buy and sell decision, because they are so fast, and as a result of that, they would, I mean, they can be program so that they will understand trigger points, buy points, sell points, so that they will automatically do buy and sell. We call it high frequency trading. And standard sector classification, and that's also a recent development, because now stock exchanges, they do use these classifications in order to facilitate their investors, so that investors are able to make their investment decisions comfortably. They can do their comparisons more meaningfully, because every stock, every company will be classified irrespective of the geographical location under common classification, so that facilitates the comparison and all the other analysis. And finally, we discussed the market classifications. There are two companies who have classified markets into three or four different baskets, and the one classification company is the MSCI, Morgan Stanley Capital International, and they have classified markets into developed, frontier, and the emerging market categories. And some other company called FTSE, they have classified these markets into four different baskets, so four different classifications. We did not discuss, by the way, that in detail. And to name the four classification baskets: frontier markets, frontier markets, those are the two ends, frontier market and the developed markets, and in between there are two categories: secondary emerging and advanced emerging market. Why these classifications are particularly important is, if we take the correlation between these two groups, any of these two groups, they are very weak, very low. Therefore, it would be a fantastic opportunity for portfolio managers or asset managers or fund managers to take the portfolio diversification better. What they can do is, when the correlation is low, we know the correlation is low, then the diversification benefit is higher. The total portfolio return, portfolio standard deviation or portfolio risk would be lower, so that they would be able to do their portfolio managements better than an environment where they don't have this classification, so that they need to go and find the stocks where the correlation is low. When the classification is done and available for their use, so that they can use those classification for the their portfolio management purposes. And with that we conclude the lesson, and thank you very much. Any questions from online students?